That's Dr. Abhishek Kothari, and he's going to speak to us about which I found a very simple, straightforward method to fight this COVID pandemic, which is ultraviolet C light. How will it act in this war against COVID, which we are all fighting? Now, over to you, doctor, please.
Thank you so much, sir. Now, UVC light is not something that is very new. It has been around for quite some time, but its role during the COVID pandemic has been highlighted manifold. I installed UVC light in my OPD and my OT, quite some time back. And then I felt so gratified that, it is helping us out in this time. So that's why I chose this topic for myself. Now, what is UVC? We all talk about UV light. That is the beyond visual spectrum light. It has a shorter wavelength than the blue light, so we can't see it. Now, UV light can be divided into three, that is UVA, UVB, and UVC, progressively as the wavelength shortens. So UVC has the shortest of the UV wavelengths. And, the only reason all of us are alive and on Zoom and talking and we have evolved into human beings is because we have an ozone layer. Because UVC is so strongly biocidal that life would never have evolved on Earth if there was no ozone layer. So UVC is almost completely filtered out by ozone. And now that we've realized its germicidal capabilities, we are using it for our purposes. In UVC also, there are two bands. One is the far UVC, that is the between 205 to 222 nanometer light. And the normal UVC that we use, that is the that is referred to light between 200 nanometer to 280 nanometer. Now, these are slightly different. Far UVC has a very, very low penetrance. So that's why it can be used when you are around. Whereas when you are using UVC, you should not have direct exposure to that light. Now, let's come to the history. Like I said, UVC is not new. More than 100 years back in 1903, that was the first time that they discovered that UV spectrum is biocidal. And then in 1932, Eris and Nutling, they discovered that it is basically 524 nanometer. That is the most biocidal. In 1957, it was first used for TB control. And currently also, the maximum use that UVC in healthcare has pre-COVID has been in TB control. TB wards have it, TB OPDs have it. And in 1999, WHO actually recommended UV germicidal light for illumination for TB control. The first time it was used as an antiviral control was in 2014, when in US, they use it as a, in the biocontainment units for Ebola patients. How does it work? So the maximum germicidal efficiency is at 254 nanometer. Most of the UV lamps in use, they have a peak at 260 to 265 nanometer, and they have a significant amount of light at the germicidal range. So they are able to kill the microbes. So whenever there is an incoming photon, it basically disrupts the DNA of the microorganism, be it bacteria, viruses, or fungi. And that it basically causes a photodimerization. So even after the UV exposure is gone, the DNA cannot recombine back and start functioning again. So that is what happens with this. And you may all know that it's not new UV. All of our houses have either an aqua guard or an RO filter. All of them have been using UV light for sterilization of water since times immemorial. It's been a long time that it has been used. For air, in a lot of infectious disease units, they use these ceiling mounted system or high up on the walls, they have something what they call as upper air sterilization mounts. Now, commonly, what are the UV sources that are available to us? The most common available is the Philips tube. They are the TUV T8 range. You have it in from 11 watts to going up to 36 to 40 watts. You have the same from Osram, both are German companies. There's no Indian tube light manufacturer that makes it. They are both basically low pressure mercury vapor lamps, and they are almost similar to the normal tube lights that you have. But the only difference being that the vapor in the normal tube lights is one of the neon gases, non-reactive gases. Here it is mercury. Also, the other difference is that most of our tube lights are coated with a phosphorescent dye on the inside. These have clear glass. And the glass is such that it does not absorb the UV light. So that is also something that there are certain Chinese manufacturers, vendors, and things which are there in the market. But if the glass is not good, the efficiency of a UV tube light will drop to almost 10% if the glass is not especially made. There is another very important property of the glass in proper UV tube lights. This glass allows only the germicidal UV to exit, whereas it traps the even shorter wavelength. Why is that important? Because the even shorter wavelengths, they cause ozone formation. So if you use those lights, if all the radiation is exposing coming outside, you will have ozone formation inside the room, which is unhealthy. It can cause upper respiratory tract irritation, and it can cause diseases also. That is why they say that if you've kept a room closed with UV light on for more than an hour, you're supposed to get it ventilated for about 10 to 15 minutes before you start using it. The other very cheap source of and very effective source of UVC is the LEDs that have now become available. They come as strips. You can have them light up on both sides or on one side, and we've used this quite well. One thing you have to understand, LEDs produce a fair amount of heat also. There are also broad spectrum UV lamps available in the market. Please do not go for that because they are completely useless. The amount of UVC produced there is much less as compared to B and A. So they're almost ineffective. Now the lethal dose for SARS-CoV is in the range of approximately 5,000 millijoules. That is basically 108 millijoule of flux for about 50 seconds. This is not a very, it's not a very high range, not a very low range. It comes somewhere in the mid range. Most bacteria and viruses get inactivated at that. Fungal spores take a much higher dose to get neutralized. So even if you have UV, do you know whether it is effective or not? So there are these packs of 50 cards available in the market, which indicate the dose that whether the correct dose is being delivered. So the card is like this. It comes from American Ultraviolet company. And if there is a 500 millijoule of irradiance, 500 millijoule per centimeter square, the center square becomes orange. And if it is 1000 millijoule, it turns pink. So you know that it is effective. In case in some corner of your room, it is only 500 millijoules, whereas we want it for if we want a higher value, then you're supposed to increase the exposure time accordingly. You also have these meters, dosimeters. I don't think we need to buy it because we don't use it that much. But if you really want to test every corner of a room, you can have these UVC light meters, which tell you exactly the microwatt per centimeter square that is landing on the particular area. Now, we have three applications in healthcare: surface sterilization, air sterilization, and instrument disinfection, where we currently use UV light. Surface disinfection, you have a wide range, you know, from the micro USB attachable attachment that I'm showing to these mobile and portable devices, to these huge devices, which you can shift from room to room. Depending upon the wattage of the light there, the UV light, you can have different exposure times, but anywhere between 10 to 20 minutes is the exposure time. You can easily shift these room to room, and these will always sterilize the surfaces that are illuminated. It is not going to work in the shadow. It has no indirect effect. So you have to make sure that the supposedly contaminated area is exposed well to these lights. For a room, if you want to make sure that your consultation room or your waiting room is sterilized, this is a rough guideline that is somewhere in the literature. So if you have a 10 by 7 room, like an optometric cubicle, of 130 watt tube light is enough. But if you have something like a 10 into 13 or a 12 into 14 room, then either 2 30 watt or 1 36 watt for the smaller room and 2 36 watt for a bigger room, either on opposite or on, in two opposite corners, you need this light to be able to achieve a kill properly. So this is my, this is an example of how I have been using it. I have a UV tube light, at two walls. And again, in my waiting room below, I have one on this wall and one on the other wall. So we make sure that we switch it on whenever there are no patients, and that makes sure that the surface contamination is removed. UV is also very useful for mask surface sterilization. There are chambers in which on both sides you have UV lamps, and you can put your mask, and in approximately 12 to 15 minutes, you have a mask that is free of the coronavirus contamination. There are For larger institute, there are these kind of chambers available that are very effective in using them for mask sterilization. For air disinfection, also UV is used in a lot of the HVAC units. you see there are arrays of UV lights which make sure that both your filter gets all the viruses and the bacteria on the filters get killed, and in the air also whatever is there gets killed. These here the UV wattage is very high, so that in that very small amount of time, the very small contact time that the airflow is going to be there, they can achieve a kill. Philips also has these things which have a concealed UV light which you can install in your OPDs, and this filters air on a continuous basis. For small OPD instruments nowadays, a lot of these UV sterilization chambers are available where you can put your instrument in and switch it on, and in about 10 minutes you can get your things sterilized. So we use we have something like this. This I designed long time back. This is using a UV LED. So we created an array of LEDs in between and surrounded by foil in a thermocol box along with a 12 watt source. And I think all of you can easily make it at home. So we put our 20D lenses, our trial frames, our sterile depressors, personal articles, sometimes the mask that we use for infants, the toys that we use for examining children, all that we put it here for sterilization. Are there any limitations of UV light? Of course there are. You cannot use the normal UVC when the room is in active use. For that, you need the far UVC lights, which are a little difficult to obtain, the 222 nanometer ones. Some brands do produce ozone, like I said, and they can cause respiratory symptoms. So it is always better that if you're using UV light, if it's been on for some time, leave the room open for a short while. For 2-3 minutes is sufficient. Continuous UV exposure can cause discoloration of plastic. You see the top photo. That is cover by Zeiss. One is my fundus camera, the other which is not exposed to the UV light, and the other is OCD in my room. You see the amount of discoloration that has happened. So your plastics will look aged if you use them, if you expose them to UV light quite a bit. Apart from this, for humans, if you are continuously exposed to UVC light, you will have skin irritation. And I myself have suffered from photokeratitis when I was doing in the early phase of COVID. When I made this box and then I put up these UV lights in my home. So I got exposed for more than a minute and I got a severe photokeratitis. So this is how your eye will become red. And if you stain, you have a SPK kind of a picture, and it is really painful for at least a day or so. So these are the limitations of UV light, but otherwise it's a fantastic way. Don't go for these handheld instruments. You know, you have these handheld lights which people wave. There is something called a contact time, which is required. So fixed devices which stay without moving for at least 10 to 15 minutes are useful. And UVC has very effective germicidal action. It is easily implementable with minimum expenditure. It also reduces the environmental risk of air exposure manifold, can be used for sterilizing masks. But be careful not to expose yourself for long, because otherwise you have a very painful day ahead. Thank you so much.
Very nice presentation, Abhishek. So even I had that problem, you know, I used to keep those UV lights on and I had that problem of getting, you know, photokeratitis. So I think that's one thing we need to learn, you know, when to switch it off and when to have it on. So you can invite the next speaker now, Abhishek. Unmute yourself.
Okay, so Dr. Deepa is going to take the next talk. That is, it's essentially a summary of all that we have said, plus a few new things, and how basically we make sure that our OPDs and OTs are run so that we have the least exposure and we are safe while examining patients in these times. So I think it's a useful listening for the coming wave, the third wave.
Yes.